I'm Scott Hambrick.
I'm Karl Schutt.
And I am Trent Jones.
And today on the Music and Ideas podcast, we're going to talk about maybe neither, because we're talking about Depeche Mode's album, Violator, which Trent Jones said is, I think he said it was the perfect pop album. Is that what you said?
No, I said it's a perfect album.
Oh, a perfect album. Oh,
which is,
okay.
There's a big difference.
You're right. There is a difference.
There's a big difference here. It's a big difference. I didn't say it was the perfect album. I don't even think it's the best album. I don't know how it could come up with a best album, but it's certainly extremely good in my book. And I think it's an example of an album that just, it hits on all fronts. There's hardly a bad song on
all
it.
All fronts? I think it hits on the goth front.
Yeah.
And then misses on the rest of them.
Is this a goth album, though?
I don't know what it is.
I don't know that this is a goth album. I think it's definitely part of the aesthetic. It's definitely part
of
it. But
all right, so my experience with this album, so I have to tell you children out there the story. In the old days, we couldn't stream music. So you had to buy it. And before you had CDs are ancient technology. They're these round things that you have music on. We had different round things that were made of vinyl that had grooves in them. And you would go get it. You would go to the store and you couldn't listen to it first, at least not the stores that I went to. I didn't go to the groovy stores. And you would say, well, I think I want to get this one. And then you would take it home and you'd listen to it like, oh my gosh, this is crap. But then you're like, well, I bought it.
Right.
I better listen to it and figure out if I like it.
Yeah.
So, you know, that time I bought Pat Benatar's fourth album, Get Nervous, when I was a kid, and I thought I would like it, and I had to keep listening to it until I did. That's kind of how this was, only I think it's better than that Pat Benatar album. I think it's actually pretty good after about 11 tries through it. It's not my usual lane. It appears on the surface to be, you know, kind of all the colors from A to B. to my ear, the first listening.
The colors from A to B.
Yeah, and so I had to dig a bit to see what was going on. But my verdict is, yeah, it's pretty good. I don't think it's a love story, though, Trent.
Okay. Well, let's talk about that. Yeah, so this is an electronic album. It's the first thing we've listened to, I think, that is almost entirely electronic. I guess there's a guitar here and there. There's an electric guitar here and there, but it is predominantly electronic music with human vocals. So I picked it for a variety of reasons. Number one, we haven't really listened to any electronic music. Number two, I was thinking about when we did the Beethoven episode, we talked about romanticism and what that means, what it is as a sort of arch genre, if you will. It's not really a genre, but I guess like an aesthetic. And I think this album came to mind because I think it is a great example of a romantic album. I think it's also a gothic album. I was messing with you earlier, Scott. I do think it is a gothic album. And what is the gothic? I think the gothic is sort of like the dark world. If romanticism is the light world, gothic is the flip side of the coin. It's a highly stylized emotional exploration, or an exploration of emotion, but primarily on the dark sides of human emotion. And so I thought we'd explore that a little bit. But I have a question first. What is an album?
Well,
good question.
I would say that this is an album first. It's not just a collection of songs.
Right. So an album, back in the old days when you had, you know, two sides, how much music could you get on it? Like 50, 45 minutes, something like that?
Yeah, maybe.
And so you would, if you were the artist, you could just put a bunch of your little pop tunes on there. Or you could say, and that was kind of the fun, actually. You could make an album that had its own aesthetic, that it had its own structure to the whole thing. I would say that an album is something like a symphony.
Well,
if you've done it well.
It goes back farther than that. I have some albums. So you're talking about, you know, the full LP, long play disc and you have multiple tracks on one side.
Right.
But before that, 45s would be a single, right? It's a smaller disc. It's smaller than a Frisbee. It's got one song each side, 45 RPMs. Before that, there were 78s. So you would buy singles, but they were the mm-hmm. same size as the LP that you're used to seeing in the Led Zeppelin album, quote unquote. So I have some albums that are 78s. I have some a Mills Brothers album. So they would come out with, you know, 14 songs, and they would have it on 78 RPM discs that went in a book, like a photo album. And so that's where it's from. It's not an isolated like single or a 45. Mm. So if somebody wanted to put out, you know, a unified release of songs along some sort of a theme, and that theme might just be the recording date for the Mills Brothers, for example, you could go to the store and you could buy that whole Mills Brothers album.
Right.
So I have a Fats Waller album, a Mills Brothers, I think I've got the, and some other stuff. But that's from, and then later on, LP, the long play 45 RPM record, that's the like what you're talking about, Karl. And then by the time that comes on, you know, people are treating that album, side one and side two, side A and side B, as like one artistic artwork. Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So it's an interesting thing because an album basically is a sales unit if you look at it one way. You know, it's the product of recorded music, which is an artifact of the 20th century and, you know, developing recording and playback technology. And as technology developed, we were able to fit more music on the same disc. And you could go, like you said, you could go from 78s to 45s to, you know, to EPs to LPs and to the 8-track and the CD and so on and so on. So there's definitely like a commercial influence to the commerce influences the format. But by the time we get to the 70s, there's kind of this artistic shift too in like what we consider an album to be as an artistic endeavor, not just a unit of sale. And, you know, I think we may have moved past that point today in 2021, but there's this interesting time frame of roughly 50 years where we have things that were meant to be sold together, like collections of songs that were meant to be sold together, but they were also written with the intent of hanging together. And I don't think we've listened yet on this podcast to an album in this modern 20th century sense. Like, you know, when you listen to Buddy Holly and the Crickets, that's an album, but it's a collection of Buddy Holly songs. It's a collection of singles, and it's great. It has a common aesthetic quality to it because it's Buddy Holly and his band, and he has a unique sound, but they're not really meant to work together as a whole. It's sort of a bunch of individual songs. And that's certainly a valid way to make an album, but you can go a little bit further with this and push it into more of a symphonic direction. And I think that's what mm-hmm. that's part of what makes this album so interesting.
Yeah, I think that's right. I was just thinking about albums. And I know you guys, I know Scott doesn't like this band, but one of the things that would change, the album determines, the LP album, which isn't the 70, the LP album determines the art that goes on it. And so I was thinking of two of my favorite albums, which are Moving Pictures and 2112 by Rush. I know we're never going to do Rush on this show. But like Moving Pictures, there's four hard rocking tracks on side one. One of them's an instrumental. And then you flip it over and you have 10 minutes of the camera eye. You flip it over and you get this long meditative weird thing that they're doing. Same thing with 2112. You have like the 20 minutes on the front side, which is a little rock opera, and then you've got some songs in praise of marijuana on the back, I think. No, it's what is that song? There's a drug song on the back of that album. But you flip it over, so you have to go to your machine and flip it over. It's like an intermission built into the form. And I was thinking, we've probably gotten away with that. It probably started with, this is still in the distant past, with Napster, when now you could take your Apple iPod thing and you could download. Oh, I just want a track. I just want Tom Sawyer. I don't want that whole album.
Yeah.
And so you download the one and you separate it from what the artists intended it to go with. And for some artists, it's no big deal. You know, it's just, you know, sure, take a song here and there.
Yeah.
But I think some of the more interesting stuff, the whole album has a structure like, someday we're going to do Dark Side of the Moon.
Right.
Speaking of
yeah.
Albums.
Well, you know, if we think about, if we go back to the symphony comparison, you know, if I dropped you into the middle of, you know, movement three or the end of movement three of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, you'd kind of be like, what is this? It's all quiet mm-hmm. and soft and like just seems to be meandering. It's kind of like, it doesn't make any sense. But we talked about how that perfectly sets up movement four where the symphony goes bonkers, right? So there, it's a work that's meant to be listened in its entirety because you've got foreshadowing, musical foreshadowing, you've got callbacks, you've got variations on a theme, all this different stuff that sort of makes it its own unique experience. And I think there's one other thing that's interesting about this album, and then we can maybe start listening to a little bit of it, is that with the advent of recorded technology, you can control the aesthetic, I think, of the recorded album more tightly than Beethoven could control the aesthetic. So a symphony is a very high aesthetic thing. It's a very highly evolved thing. But Beethoven still couldn't control, I mean, he was limited to the space that he was performing in. Now, some composers were actually able to create their own space, like Wagner. But for the most part, they're limited to...
He had to build a building to do it.
Yeah, he had to build his own building to do it. It's kind of cost prohibitive for most folks. And if your music is going to go live on after the debut performance that you directed yourself, then you don't have any control over what happens to that music. But with a recorded album, it can be duplicated perfectly. And so you can really control this, the space, the sonic space and the sonic experience more tightly. And I think this album is stellar in the way that the production controls the sense of space and guides your experience through the songs. So that it's operating on, I think, on a few different levels. You've got the song, you've got the performance, which in this case is the vocals and then, you know, I think primarily the vocals. And then you have the production, which is the thought and craftsmanship that goes into selecting sounds and tweaking them and putting them in a space that influences the way that you hear this music. And because this is gothic music or romantic music, it's got to put a very particular shade of color on the lens through which you're going to experience this.
So my oldest daughter and I had to go do some errands the other day, and I said, "Well, you're driving." And she said, "Well, then I get to control the radio." I said, "No, you don't understand how this shit works. I'm not one of your friends. I get to control the music." And she said, "Okay." I said, "Well, we have to listen to Depeche Mode's 1990 album, Violator." And she said, "All right. Why?" And I said, "Well, Trent says it's the greatest album of all time." I was wrong about that. I misquoted you, Trent. So we turned this on, and it's track one is "World in My Eyes." We were listening to the 2006 remaster, right? Because I couldn't find the original 1990 cut on Spotify or where I get music that like this. So we turned this on, "World in My Eyes." And she hit stop because she can control it with her steering wheel. She got a little button on her steering wheel. She's like, "Why did they start this album with this song?" And I was like, "You know, because they didn't want you to be hooked on it yet." I don't know. Trent, this whole thing like swings and misses for me. You're gonna have to help me. I don't want to be mean about
it.
Right. I can't figure it out.
All right.
I can't figure it out. "World in My Eyes," track one.
Thank you.
there we go. We've got the intro to this album, and we get the first verse of the song and a little instrumental break. So right off the bat, like there's some very strong aesthetic choices being made here. Number one, it's just entirely, you know, this is kind of, if you had to put it in a genre, I guess you would call it synth pop. You know, it's part of the pop music of the, you know, 80s that evolved. You know, Depeche Mode, I think, started in the early 80s. And if you listen to the really early stuff, it's like this weird, just happy, like cartoonish sounding synth music. I don't know really how to describe it, but it's completely different from this album. But the synthesizer made great strides in the 80s, and people became interested in trying to create pop music with the synthesizer. But that's what we have here. We have this sort of, it's synthetic music, but we've got real human vocals on it. This isn't Daft Punk or anything. And he's beckoning you in with the lyrics into this album. Let me take you on a trip around the world and back. Let me show you the world in my eyes. And so you've got this like lens that he's putting on the on the music and your experience of it right off the bat. It's dark, it's sexy, it's seductive.
Now, I want to ask, so is this sequenced synthesizer music? Maybe we ought to talk. Did what's his name, Gore, like program all of this stuff?
I think it's a little bit of both. So what Karl's referring to is that with the synthesizer, you can play it freeform, like you would a piano or, you know, another instrument. And you can record that. Or a lot of synthesizers by the 80s had this ability to store information in like crude, you know, digital form, and you could play back patterns, or you could play something into the synthesizer and have it repeat in a loop. And that would be sequencing. And I think it's a little bit of both. I think there's the drums are probably mostly sequenced, and then they would play the melody lines on top of that.
So one reason, well, I noticed that. So when we're doing playback, so I'm hearing it from Scott's computer through the internet, and the music will speed up and slow down depending on network load, I guess, on my end. And for me, that kills the effect. It's got to be, I mean, this isn't Art Blakey. This has got to be 100% dead on rhythm, because I think to listen to this right, you kind of have to get lost in it. I think you need to put headphones on probably, or have a good stereo, because there's a lot of separation in the effects. I wrote down the word pointillistic. You know, it's kind of, there's little pops here and there of music. It's like, this is 1990 they put this out, so they were recording it in 89, I guess.
Yeah.
Nowadays, to do something like this, so if you took Reaper, which I know is the software Trent uses, or Pro Tools or something, you can kind of paint a song where you take little effects or little sequenced patterns and you just cut and paste, or you drag them with a paintbrush or something. And it sounds like that's what they did.
Yeah, absolutely. So, but in 1990, all of the technology that now is inside the computer in a software program was in physical boxes. It was early digital equipment. So, you know, you had to take a box.
Gosh, 1990 was the dark ages.
And write a code to tell it to, you know, to play a note at a given time and make a pattern of it. But yeah, I think you're right. So to understand the production that's happening here, you have to listen to all the layers that are going on in this music. So there's a melody line, and there's all these little accent lines that'll play in between the beats, and then they're repeated maybe one or two times left and right in the stereo field. So, you know, if we kind of draw a continuum from the left speaker all the way over to the right speaker, there's a continuum of where you can place objects, if you will, like sonic objects in the mix. And we call that the stereo field. But what's really interesting about all the layers in this album is how precisely a sound will be placed in the stereo field and then repeated on the opposite end of the stereo field. But it's not a delay like you would hear in the natural world, where it's like bouncing off of a canyon or something, right? It'd be like a natural delay that has a decay time, like echo, 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 echo. No, it's actually, it's just a single echo. dun 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 dun. So the production is really very tightly controlling your experience of space in this mix. So it's really this artificial world that the band is creating and asking you to step into. It has a mechanical heartbeat that's a little alienating. It's a little dark. And I think that is a key part of this album, you know, this album experience, part of the aesthetic, is the fact that it's a little cold, but I think it juxtaposes nicely against the vocals, which are, you know, kind of, I don't know, how would you describe those? Like dark, commanding?
That's a little threatening. They're ambiguous. Yeah. So trying to figure out what's going on here. Lyrically, it's an invitation, but to what? You, the listener, are supposed to sit still and take a trip. But then he says, let my body do the talking.
Yeah.
Which makes me think, this might be sex.
You're like, you weigh 150 pounds. I don't want to. It's gross.
Let my body do the moving. I mean, where's that line? All the heavens in the motion.
Yeah. I'll take you to the highest mountain, to the depths of the deepest sea, and we won't need a map, believe me.
Now, but then it gets... to where it gets really dark. It's a little bit after where we stop the track. This chorus, that's all that there is. There's nothing more than you can feel now. That's all there is. Let my hands do the soothing. Let me show you the world in my eyes. That's all. The feeling that the song is getting, or that you're getting from whoever's talking to you, is
that's it. Full stop. So Trent, I worked at my first and only job around this time when this album came out. And so I can't even listen to this without being taken back to 1990, you know?
Right.
And this chick I worked with, she said, hey, come over to so-and-so's house. We're having a, I don't think she said party, a get-together after work. I said, okay, that'd be good. So I drove over to this address, which I knew from the address, like, okay, this is kind of a lower middle class Tulsa. Okay. So I get there, and it was older guys lived there. So I was in 1990, I was 16, 17. So these guys were 21, 22, 23, probably 21, 22.
Yeah.
All of the walls were painted, and the ceilings in every room I went in, I didn't go in all the rooms, were all painted either black or like purple, such that it was almost black, like this really dark purple or black.
I think I went to that party. Was that in South Bend, Indiana?
It was not. It was in East Tulsa, which is now the Barrio. And there were all these chicks there that were wearing chokers and black. And like people like just making out in this corner, or like dog piled up in this other corner. And this kind of shit was playing. And that's not the only time I was kind of in that scene. I was not of that scene, but I was in it. So I'm listening to this song, and it's this invitation. And then I was around some of these people that were either taking up either that physical or spiritual invitation that he's offering here. When I was around those folks, I didn't see any drugs. They weren't smoking weed. They didn't even have beer. It's pre-MDMA. Yeah. There's no ecstasy. There's no ketamine. These people were trying to live in an altered state on a zero budget. And And they were all like middle class kids who were, I mean, they weren't so traumatized and messed up that they were actually legit self-destructive, right? Like they weren't on heroin, you know, they weren't taking LSD. I'm sure there was some of that, and maybe I was just with some posers, but most of the people that bought this would have been sort of mainstream or maybe more like this. So it is about an aesthetic. I mean, I was in their houses. That's not the only one I was ever in.
Yeah.
They're trying to have some sort of an experience. And then I listened to this song and then the rest of the album, and he is trying to paint some sort of an aesthetic. He's trying to create an aesthetic, but it's very tightly constrained. Like there aren't very many dynamics in here. The volume doesn't go up and down. There aren't a lot of key changes, tempo changes, not a lot of tension release, you know, with, you know, the chord structures don't, you know, invite tension in the release. And you know, he's not doing what Beethoven's doing. And I'm not saying that it's because the Depeche Mode guys aren't talented. They have consciously chosen to like stuff down all of the experiences, the potential number of experiences you could have while you're doing this, so that now you're in a house that smells funny with dark purple walls.
Yeah. This is the world in my eyes.
Yeah.
So, well, let me, okay, I think you're getting somewhere there. Let me give you, let me draw a comparison here and see if it rings true for you.
The girls all wear chokers.
Do you watch horror movies?
I have been known to.
Okay, yeah. I mean, so, like, Karl, have you seen a horror movie?
Yeah.
Yeah, so when you watch a horror movie, why do you watch it? Like, do you watch it to see virtuous people doing virtuous things?
Mostly nowadays, I watch the funny horror movies.
Okay, yeah, it could be funny.
Tucker and Dale versus Evil, you know.
Yeah, they can be sort of like parody.
But no, I get it's a mood that you want to get into, and actually, I don't watch them that much anymore because I don't want to be in that mood. But
yeah, there's you know, see, I think you watch them to have, I mean, to get a rise, right? To experience the world in a different view than you normally do. It's I don't know if I would call it escapism because you're intentionally looking for a strong experience. I think when you engage with
this. Is the album like a Raymond Chandler novel?
You know, I've never
like,
read Raymond
it's always
Chandler,
raining so. In Los Angeles, and you know, like the experience is constrained to just certain types of people, and you know, there's nothing particularly happy.
Well, I don't know about that. I think, how about Jane Eyre? That's what comes to mind when I hear this.
I hate that book.
Jane Eyre.
But I get your point.
Well, okay, Dracula.
Right.
You know, it's like, think about what happens in Gothic literature, right? Like, you usually have a romance of some kind. It's a romance, but it's also like a, you know, it's like looking at it through the dark side of the lens. It's the exploring the dark side of love, right? Sex, exploring possession, obsessiveness, jealousy. I think that's where this album is starting off, is it's exploring love through the dark lens first. And if you think about the way horror works, I think it's a good metaphor because in a horror movie, or even if you read the book Dracula, you know, the first part of the book, it takes place in a castle. So when you go up the stairs, you can't see what's in front of you because they wind in a circle. You can't see around the hallway. Everything's dark. There's no windows unless you happen to get to a spot, you know, to an outer facing room. And even then, you can't really see that far. So physically, you know, the world is very contained and constrained. And the same thing is true in horror movies and cinema now, is that, you know, if you want to make a good horror movie, you need to introduce the suspicion that there's something down the hall on the doorway to the right, but you never can quite see very clearly down the hall on the doorway to the right. If you could see it, it would totally kill the mood, right?
The anticipation, yeah. It's like there's a cadence that never happens in this album. You know, there's a chord change and resolution that never quite happens. But there is contrast. I don't know if Scott's got the needle where we left off. But
yeah. So
you've got that bum, that pointillistic feel in this song. And then you get to the chorus, which I think is probably the key part of this song, that's all there is, where it just changes. The feeling changes. It's fake strings, I think, synthesized strings. And you do get that kind of contrast in a bunch of these songs. Believe me.
That double vocal there.
And then you're back.
Right.
So that's why I say you got to kind of listen to it in headphones, and you have to. This is vague too, but you have to get into the groove. You have to just kind of bop along with it so that those little changes will hit you. We listened to it the first time we listened to it. I put it on in our minivan as we were driving. We were driving to a wedding in Indiana. So listening to it, and you just can't quite get it because there's too much road noise. And one of my daughters just hated it. And the other one's like,
is it actually possible to get it? You know, Violator from Depeche Mode in a minivan with your five kids and your wife going to a wedding in Indiana. Like, you can't do it.
No, it's not.
You have to be in the wrong place. A house in East Tulsa with no furniture.
So, why do you put this song first on the album? I think this calls back to what is an album. And I think if you're going to create an experience, and you want to draw somebody in, you want to suck them into a world that's like, hey, we're leaving your normal day-to-day world through your eyes, and we're coming to my world now. This is I'm in control. Then you can't come out swinging with the number one single, you know, that's going to be on the radio. You're giving up all the goods before you get started. And that's the way most pop albums start.
Well, this is a first date, right? You don't.
On Tinder.
Well, I mean,
no,
I think this does describe
like when you have a young relationship, and the physical attraction is there. That's what's happening in this song. Now, this is a very masculine energy that the singer is channeling. He's in control. He's delivering the experience. Let my body do the talking. But I think you make that choice because you're trying to suck someone into your world, and if you come out with something that's just immediately, you know, poppy and groovy, then it doesn't suck you in quite as much. It's too immediately satisfying. You've got to pull people in and give them just enough of a hook to keep going. Scott's not buying it.
Well, no, he's certainly painting a picture and setting an expectation for what the aesthetic of this album is and what the experience of it is. There's no question. This album and Depeche Mode are mighty important to this subculture that clung to this aesthetic, whatever it is. Now, my hillbilly ass in that room with the dark purple and the weird carpet and everything, like I it didn't jive with me, but it was everything to those people. And I've listened to this. I didn't listen to it 11 times like Karl did. I think I was 5 times. And thinking about it in terms of that subculture that existed at that time, poor old Trent was what, 7?
Oh, no. I was just born.
Oh, okay.
I was born in 89.
Oh, so
8 months old.
Well, this was still alive.
A year old, maybe.
This was a real live counterculture. This was, or a subculture. No, maybe not counterculture, but it was a real live subculture. This was a group of kids that you would see at your school, right? And there have been those kinds of subcultures since probably the 1930s. You know, there were the weirdos that wore the raccoon coats and drove roadsters in the late 30s. There were Bobby Soxers. There were later beatniks. And then there were hippies. And then maybe there were, you know, the FM radio long hairs that listened to Southern rock where I was from. Maybe there's outlaw country. Maybe there's punk. And then at some point, 96 or so, you start to see, maybe even 83, 84, you start to see these people that listen to this weird, dark British electronic music. And I'm like, why is that the subculture at this time? So there was like a heavy metal subculture in 1990. And there was certainly a hip-hop rap one. There were all of us that hated Garth Brooks. And then there's this one. And I'm like, what is it? And I think that the heavy metal one and this one are distinctly Generation X. And I think this is a reaction to the happy bullshit that the hippies had and the sort of political activism and disaffectedness that the punks had. I think this is just, I think this shows a cynical, dark worldview and a yearning for some sort of intense experience that those Generation X kids had. There. So these guys were in their late 20s. The Depeche Mode guys are not Generation X. I think Dore or whatever his name was. I think he was born in 61. I looked it up earlier. But, you know, all of those kids that I knew that listened to this and Shit Bats and all that stuff, all were latchkey kids. Their parents had all been divorced twice or three times. Everything was a mess. They had a half dozen stepsisters and brothers from a different family. Nothing made any sense. You know, mom and dad were remarried, and both of them had lake houses, and everything looked fun, but it was not for the kids. It was not. And so the instant they moved out, they painted the place they rented, they painted it black. They dated girls with chokers, and listen to this.
Yeah, that's probably right.
Yeah.
There you go.
I was thinking it's not dark enough.
It's not dark enough. It's not dark enough. And so my daughter said, why are you listening to this and not Pretty Hate Machine? Nine Inch Nails. And I was like, you're right. I mean, Nine Inch Nails, Pretty Hate Machine came out the fall before this. It is blast. I mean, are they the same class?
I think so.
I mean, that Pretty Hate Machine, I couldn't believe it. When that came out, I was like, what is this? I could get on board with that.
Sure, sure. Well, I think what's interesting is the goths, that has turned out to be a very durable counterculture and subgenre. Mm-hmm. You know, we had goths in high school in 2003.
Culture still reacting.
There's goths today.
The culture, youth culture, is still reacting to the ridiculous delusion of the boomers. They're still in control. Like, youth culture is still reacting to the boomers. Of course, it's durable.
Yeah, and so I think so. If we keep going with this album, we'll get a better idea of what these, you know, what people that are into this subgenre, this culture, we're trying to get to. And I think a big part of this is romance. Okay, so it's cynical to start with, right? It's like we start this album off with sex. And the next song, Sweetest Perfection, is, you know, I would say it's kind of like an exploration of possessiveness, of jealousy. You know, that when you're in high school or even college and you have that first, you know, serious girlfriend, it's you feel that way. At least from the masculine perspective.
No, I'm still that way.
But I think, you know, what we have to do is we have to take, because this is an album, these songs are all meant to hang together. We have to take the full arc of the album into consideration. And it's really interesting where this album turns when you get to the center of it. We've got Waiting for the Night, Enjoy the Silence, Policy of Truth. And I think that's what makes this thing interesting is, okay, we're starting here, but we're not going to stay here in World of My Eyes. But it does color the rest of the experience. We have to take what comes after, too. So,
yeah, I don't know if... Oh, gosh, there's nine tracks. If we do track by track, this is going to be long, which is good. Sweetest Perfection is like a scherzo. It's like a triplet feel. I like how the structure of the song matches. The Sweetest Perfection to calm out. And if you read this, I'm waiting for the sentence to close. And there's no verb. So the sweetest perfection to call my own, the slightest correction couldn't finally hone, the sweetest infection of body and mind, the sweetest injection of any kind. What's the sentence there? So it's like this guy at that party in East Tulsa, you know, sees the goth girl over there with the choker, and he's like, wow, that's the thing for me. But, you know, maybe he's disillusioned. He's like, I can't approach I don't know how to do this. I can't even get my thoughts to close. And if you look at the T-I-O-N words, perfection, correction, infection, injection, it's like bordering on the drugs. It's like, right. Wow, she's something, but I can't do it. And then the verse, I stop and I stare too much, afraid that I care too much. Ugh.
Well, because you're going to get divorced because your mom and dad got divorced.
And I hardly dare to touch. Yeah. So let's listen to the first verse and chorus of this one. Also, really cool drum programming. I mean, you don't hear, like, this is not EDM where it's four on the floor, doom, 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 doom. It's some really interesting and different.
When I was in college, when this came out, we called it Eurotrash music.
Me too. I got a hold of, around this time, around 1980,
yeah.
I was able to borrow an 808. An acquaintance had a Roland 808 drum machine. And I borrowed that thing. Dude, it was easier to learn how to be a drummer than to program in sequence with that thing.
To program the machine.
Yeah, it was terrible.
Yeah, well, that was... I wasn't saying Eurotrash to because I like this track, but all of that European music of that time had programmed drums.
Yes.
And most of it sounded the same.
Yeah, yep. Right.
Sweetest perfection.
Like, how do you program that?
The sweetest perfection to call my own. The slightest correction couldn't finally hone. The sweetest infection, the body and mind. Sweetest injection of any kind. I stop and I stare too much, afraid that I care too much. And I hardly dare to touch, for fear that the spell may be broken. When I need a drug in me, and it brings out the thug in me. Feel something tug.
I want the real thing, not tokens.
So, Karl, you said this might be about drugs.
Might be.
So let's go back to the horror movie aesthetic, right? Like, why did he say injection, and why did he say, when I need a drug in me, and it brings out the thug in me? So I think, you know, this is goth music. You got to be edgy, right? You got to be an edgelord. And I think this is 1990. This is 30 years ago. It's still, you know, it still is taboo at that time to reference drug use.
You think it's just shock value?
Yeah. I think there's a little bit of shock value there, but I think the metaphor works on a deeper level too, right? So you got to be a little edgy. That's part of the aesthetic of the genre. But I think he's also, I read this as love songs with drug imagery, not drug songs with love imagery.
Mm.
You know, this isn't There She Goes by The Laws. He's comparing, so again, this is youthful love. He's comparing this feeling of wanting, of this intense physical attraction with you know, drug use, which he would have been perhaps familiar with in the youth culture.
Yeah, so we had this discussion on our little Slack channel, and you said, Trent, that you thought it was a love story, and I asked, is this about drugs? And you said, no, I think it's a love story. And then I think, but it could be about drugs a little, though. Because I Googled him.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
I mean, the lyricist, apparently, Dore figured out he had trouble when he was having double vodkas for breakfast, you know, and the singer had his problems. And maybe, I think he nearly died on the tour. There were some troubles.
I read a little bit about the band. Yeah, there were some drug troubles, but I do think that most of those happened after this album. Because, you know, they certainly had achieved some fame by this album by the time that Violator came out, but Violator is what blew them up to the moon. This album sold like 11 million copies, and they started doing stadium tours, and they had massive club hits.
It's so weird that this music makes it to stadiums.
Yeah.
Right. And so I think... I see what you're saying there, but I don't know that that's really, I don't see that as the primary driver of this album. So I thought that was a good question, though, and I think it does ask us, like, how do we read something like this? And I kind of ask myself when we're talking about an album like this, okay, what are the lyrics telling me? What is the performance of the vocals telling me? And what is the music telling me? And so we heard a little bit of Sweetest Perfection. As the album develops, though, the sound starts to morph a little bit, and we get a different experience. So I'm going to jump a little bit, and I want to hear a little bit of Waiting for the Night. So this is track number 5.
All right. I'm all for skipping some. All right, here we go.
Line grinding against the high melody. Isn't it? Like, what happened? What happened to our character here? I don't know this. I'm not going to say that this is a concept album. We have the same characters in every song, but our speaker, at least here, is experiencing something a little different than what happened in the first couple songs.
He wants to be away from stark reality. At night, when things are obscure. And so you think, all right, okay, so this is just one of those depressing goth songs. And then there's the verse, but there's a star in the sky guiding its way with my way with its light. And you have the happy little high synth stuff
tinkling.
Going on. Yeah, the tinkling.
Yeah, kind of mimics the stars, tinkling stars, yeah.
There's a cool thing coming out of the, I didn't plunk this out on the piano, but there's a cool thing coming out of the verse into the chorus again, where the chorus that feels almost minor at the beginning feels major coming out of the verse, even though nothing really changes.
Yeah, if you listen to the bass line there, the bass line continues the dun 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 dun, 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 and it has that kind of it. There's some dissonance between the bass line and that high twinkling synth line that occurs in the chorus.
There is a star in the sky.
So, you know, there you go. There's kind of that uneasiness that you would experience in any good gothic work has to be drenched in a mood, right? And there, it never quite lets you go, but it does turn to a more positive light here. I think this is like, this is a great setup track. You know, this is a 6 minute long track. It's slow, it's soft, it's more romantic than the preceding tracks. And it sort of shifts the direction of this album in this, into a new territory. And it sets up what would end up being the breakout monster hit from this album, which is Enjoy the Silence. And this is the one that just got blasted in clubs everywhere. It was the thing that it was the track that everybody came to see in the stadium tour. And it's a pretty song. It's a pretty romantic song.
Maybe. I don't think it's romantic, the next one. Yeah, I don't want to leave this the waiting for the night. When I squinted, the world seemed rose tinted and angels appeared to descend. To my surprise, with half closed eyes, things looked even better than when they were open. All right, so is the night and his squinting, is it revealing stuff to him or is it concealing stuff and he's making this up? All of the lyrics on this album are ambiguous. You could take this in a bad way. You could take it, well, at night I can see more clearly. I can see the star.
Right. It's also dark.
Yeah. So it's almost hopeful, even though it's, you know, not.
Yeah. I think this is why this album has an enduring quality, despite coming from that, you know, like, who remembers Echo and the Bunnymen nowadays?
I remember the name.
That's a great band. Great band from that era. There's a lot of great new wave bands, but, you know, it most of them are kind of stuck in that time period. You know, they didn't really transcend the 80s. This album has, you know, I don't have any, this is not a high school touchstone for me. And I know a lot of people that I've introduced this album to that are millennials of my age that resonate with this album. And I think because there is that cynicism from the Gen X experience that you can't quite escape. Like, it can't just be Pollyannic about life, but it is hopeful too. And I think the music is what's signaling how to take these lyrics, right? So they're written with this sort of undercurrent of cynicism, but the music ultimately says, hey, you know, to me, that's how I read this. The music is what signals you that this is actually, I'm starting to feel something inside and this might be good.
Starting to feel something inside, but we have to control it. It has to be constrained and it can't be too positive.
But then you get Enjoy the Silence. So let's listen to that track.
Let's see here. This stuff makes me just so nostalgic. Yeah. I mean, Trent wasn't born yet or whatever it was you said.
That was one.
Gross. And I was listening to that and I was just writing down the names of these local bands that I watched around that time. I was just writing these bands down. And they're not all this Eurotrash stuff, Karl, but the Thrill Kill Cult, they would come through Tulsa and I get to see them at Club Icon. Hmm. Chainsaw Kittens. I saw the Flames there. MC 900 Foot Jesus. Flannel Burns. Pitbulls on Crack. I was just writing down the names of those bands, you know. And then I looked up, I was looking on the internet and saw a bunch of concert posters from a time. All this just brings that all back to me. Which we're going to listen to Enjoy the Silence. Is that the next one?
Yeah, so that's the next one. And this is kind of, I think, the heart of the album. You know, it's track number 6. And the later tracks in the album are a little bit longer. So it's kind of sort of in the middle of the album.
Let's listen to Enjoy the Silence.
Is here in my heart.
harmony there. See, this is so interesting to me. We talked about on the last the episode we did on lyrics about subversiveness, and we brought up the laws. There she goes. On the surface, if you don't think too hard about it, it's a pretty little love song about, you know, puppy love, falling in love. But you dig a little bit, and the lyrics are pretty dark. And it's we talked about the danger of not being honest about your intentions and your feelings, and the music subverts the lyrical content. I don't know that that's what's happening here, because we get, you know, past the halfway mark in the song, and even though we have this guy who, it's like he's struggling with feeling. Yeah, you know, words are trivial. Words are meaningless and forgettable. All I ever wanted, all I ever needed is here in my arms. To me, it's like he's struggling against his own sort of like cynicism and lack of feeling.
Yeah,
probably because he saw his parents get all fucked up.
These guys are not Generation X. These guys were born in 61. These are boomers, you know. But that's not who bought it, right? They could have made this album and it went nowhere, but it's compelling for... Yeah. Record buying public at that time, which was X, and we were messing with the Gulf War. Everybody's folks were divorced. Everybody's mom was working somewhere, and they were getting off the school bus and unlocking the house and eating a fucking toaster strudel for dinner. And dad's dating a 31-year-old, and he's 46. You know, I saw it. You know, so there's one group of guys, that are a group of people that are listening to, you know, metal. There's a group that's listening to hip hop, whatever, and then there's this group. Like, it's just,
yeah, and with metal specifically, with metal at that time, you think of it. This is 1990, so metal had gotten just ridiculous. You know, we went from Dio in the mid '80s to Cherry Pie by Warrant. By the late 80s, it was just like, let's party our ass off. It was bro country. It was no different. It's same thing, you know?
Bro metal.
Girls and, yeah, bro metal. So it kind of had jumped the shark as a genre. And it wouldn't get re-energized, I think, until, you know, in the 90s when sort of grunge and some of the thrash bands, you know, reinvented themselves a little bit. But, yeah, I think it's reaction to that. So if we look at the... There's a line that just popped out to me. Vows are spoken to be broken. Feelings are intense. Words are trivial. Pleasures remain, so does the pain. Words are meaningless and forgettable. And then the chorus, all I ever wanted, all I ever needed is here in my arms.
That's the happy interpretation of the lyric.
Sure.
Yeah, the bit about vows being spoken to be broken, that's how words can do harm. You say things and then you don't live up to them. Maybe we just don't talk. On the other hand, is the little girl actually in his arms? Because you could do the drug interpretation too. All yep. I ever wanted, all I ever needed is here in my arms. Words are unnecessary. They can only do harm. You know, because you're floating away with Mr. Heroin.
Uh-oh.
They're ambiguous lyrics, I think, on purpose. Maybe the drug imagery is the love imagery, and the love imagery is the drug imagery.
Well, yeah, okay, sure. But then you have this second half of the song, and we have this, as the song evolves, we've got these like synth brass that reaches up. It's like this triumphant, like sort of searching quality to these sounds. So I think the music is pulling us towards the happy interpretation.
There isn't.
It can't be 100% happy.
There's nothing about this.
Au contraire, though. all right. So did your tracks have like, around 4:12, the music stops, and then you have this voice shouting, "Crucified."
Around 4:12,
it gets real weird at the end.
Let's go to 4:12.
Oh yeah, that's towards the end. Yeah, there's like a break.
Here's at 4:04. Let's go from here.
Enjoy the silence, and then they stop.
Enjoy the silence.
I don't think this made the radio cut.
No.
Yeah, what the heck was that? Why does the guy shout "Crucified" in the midst of "Enjoy the Silence"? Mm. What meeting did they decide to do that?
You know which meeting.
Well, I know I'm beating a dead horse on this, but the texture of this album, honestly, it does remind me of Pink Floyd. I think they were doing this sort of stuff in the 70s.
Certainly an influence, for sure.
You know, this is policy of truth, and I thought this at the time, and I still think it now, like, it's all so thin. You know, the electronic instruments and the production methods just, you know, you couldn't do Beethoven's Fifth. The technology wasn't there, and it's kind of in its infancy, and of course, now it's even worse, you know. Katy Perry's Dark Horse.
Yeah.
But this was all just so thin. It then and now, it just can't hold my attention. There's just so little happening. It's low on affect. Like, it's sad and that's all. And then the instrumentation and the arrangements are just thin and sparse. And I understand that that's the aesthetic. And that for that group, for that fan group, that is the appeal. But for me, it just missed me. And like I said, so I'm interested in this. I can't be terribly interested in it for what it is. I'm sorry, Trent. I love you. And I tried real hard. But I don't. For me, there's not all that much there. But if I look at it in its cultural context and like, why did it sell million copies? What was compelling to people about this? Like, then it's very interesting. And so like 6 months before this is Pretty Hate Machine, Nine Inch Nails. What'd you think of that one, Karl? You haven't said anything about Nine Inch Nails.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that album.
What? Okay, we'll do that one someday. And then about 10 months later, well, at right around this time, one of my friends had been, went to visit one of his cousins and stay in Seattle with his aunt and uncle and his cousins for the summer. And he came back and he gave me a cassette of Mother Love Bone, which busted up and then became Pearl Jam.
Yeah.
And then so like 6, 8, 10 months after this album is released, you get Pearl Jam 10. And I think they actually have some of the same sort of emotional effect. They're meeting the same sort of need in the fan group, this Depeche Mode thing, and the Pearl Jam album, which is superior to Nirvana in every way.
Yes,
but this stuff missed me. It just missed me. But when I got Pearl Jam 10 and that Mother Love Bone album, I was like, man, this stuff is. I mean, this is scratching an itch that I've got that I didn't know I had.
Yeah, sure. Sure. And Pearl Jam 10's phenomenal album.
Oh, my God.
That probably was the first album I remember getting when I was becoming aware of music. And it was just like, oh, my God.
So good.
Like, what is this? I can't believe it.
If Eddie Vedder had ate a shotgun when he was 28, nobody would talk about Nirvana.
Yeah. Yeah, I'd agree with that. I'd agree with that. Mother Love Bone was great too.
Yeah.
Shame that Andy Wood, the singer, died, and so they had to reform and but they found a pretty good one, Eddie Vedder.
But well, also dark. That kind of grunge.
Yeah.
Also dark. Also confused about romance. Also confused about relationships, Jeremy. But a lot more emotive. Right? There's a larger range of emotion in there. And I think that for those kids that were listening to this and loved it, and I was around a bunch of them, man, they were beat up. They couldn't they couldn't do it, man.
Have you seen the meme where there's the guy standing in the corner at the party,
yeah,
looking at the other people, and then he's thinking some thought to himself, they don't understand that inflation is, I don't know, whatever right. The meme is.
Look at them. They don't understand.
The guy in the corner is...
Everybody else is having fun.
Yeah. Depeche Mode is the guy in the corner. Not allowing himself to do the party.
Right.
At least on this album.
But within this culture,
yeah,
they could have this kind of party. I went to a bunch of them. It's the worst party you've ever seen. Like, with, like, sad making out. Think about that. If you weren't born in the 70s and went to one of those things, you cannot comprehend, like, mournfully making out with a chick. But they did it. It is like the creepiest shit you've ever seen in your life. So weird. Oh, God, it's so strange. Never let your daughters wear chokers, Trent. If you have girls, never let them wear a choker.
Are chokers in? Again?
Well, they are among...
That's a very 90s thing.
A certain group. We always said that the chokers were a black belt in oral. It was a key indicator.
Probably.
Trent has moved over to his keyboard. I wonder what he's going to show us.
Well, if you just don't buy the dark romance that this album's selling, fine. I think you can read it a couple different ways. I think the lyrics are ambiguous enough. I still think the music on balance pulls you in a certain direction. But let's talk about a little bit about the production, because that's the other thing. Like you listen to Depeche Mode, just like you listen to Nine Inch Nails, for outrageously good production. And you said you thought this music was thin.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you mean it's like the quality of the timbre or the emotional depth. Or both?
Still depth and the number of sonic tools being used. You know, like even the drum tracks will be like a snare, a kick drum, and like, you know, maybe some other weird synth noise. Maybe, you know, a single finger keyboard lines in the melody. I mean, it's real sparse. And it's on purpose. I know they're doing it for a reason.
Yeah. Well, I think it's what's interesting to me is that the sonics of this album still hold up. Like, there's a lot of stuff I can dig up from the 80s that sounds like 100% like the 80s. Like, what was that song? Like, Got You With That Science?
No, Blinded You.
Blinded You With Science.
Blinded You With Science, Thomas Dolby.
Yeah, I mean, come on. That's cornball 80s, right? Devo, Whip It. I don't know. Did that come in the 80s? That was early. Yeah.
Humanly.
It was novel for its time.
Right.
But it doesn't, like, you listen to that and you're like, yeah, I know that was 1986 or whenever it was, right? It is definitely of a time and place.
Now, are you going to tell me now, were you getting ready to tell me that Depeche Mode is not as dated as that?
I don't think so.
Oh, dude.
There are many imitators of this album that I don't think anyone has managed to capture this, like, weird dark magic that's going on with the production in this album. It's maybe a little light on the low end compared to a modern release. It was 1990, but I mean, it still sounds fresh to a lot of people. And this is not just me talking. I've introduced this album to a bunch of people. They're all about my age, all millennials, and a lot of them enjoy it. Whereas, you know, stuff from the 80s tends to have a novelty, like the synthesizer is a novel thing. But I wanted to at least, you know, maybe introduce you to electronic music and what that is and how this stuff gets made, because it is kind of interesting. I think that a good electronic music, you're not just playing an instrument, you're not just playing a keyboard, you're also becoming your own instrument maker too. It's like, not only are you going to play the instrument, you're going to make it too. And that's essentially what synthesis is. So if you take the most basic form of a synthesizer, it has an oscillator, which generates a waveform. And the most simple waveform there is, it's called a sine wave. We've all studied these in math class in high school, right? Sine wave.
Boring.
Very boring. So, but what a sine wave is it's the fundamental. So if I play a middle C, or even better, middle A, it's one frequency. So middle A in modern music is tuned to 440 hertz. We define it as 440 hertz. If when I play middle A with a sine wave, you are hearing 440 hertz and nothing else. What's interesting, though, is with synthesis, you can use different waveforms. So part of, like, what makes everything that we listen to sound like it does, what makes a trumpet sound like a trumpet and a saxophone, and so on, is the harmonic content of instruments. And with a synthesizer, essentially what you're doing is you're taking different waveforms and mixing them to create different harmonic content. So if I take my middle C and I add a harmonic, I'm still using a sine wave, I could add the second order harmonic, which would be mathematically one octave above the middle C. So I've got middle C, there's my fundamental, I'll add the second harmonic. It's an octave, but played together, it sounds fuller and richer, right? Well, you can keep going. You can play the third order harmonic, which musically would be 12 steps above the fundamental. Basically a fifth above the octave, or a 12th. And of course you could play the fifth below the octave too. All right, and starting to sound fuller and richer. So you can keep going from here, fourth order, fifth order, et cetera, et cetera. And all these harmonics can be blended together in basically an infinite number of ways. Because when we hear real sounds, you know, with physical instruments, we hear the fundamental, we hear the harmonics, and they're all blended at different levels. And then we get Karl's favorite waveform.
Yep.
The saw wave.
Wait for it.
I switched over. I'm using an analog synth now. So it just plays one note at a time.
Mm.
But that's a saw wave. When a saw wave is characterized by having essentially all of the harmonics in it. So it sounds really fat. I'm just playing one note. Sounds much fatter than this. Right? That's harmonics at play. And you get all sorts of fun stuff from there. You can use a triangle wave. You can use a square wave. These are all just have different blends of harmonics in them.
All right. So with this kind of music, every choice they're making, they've sat down and said, well, what kind of, you have to design the instrument, design the sound that you want to play this particular little synth pop thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because early on, they were just waveform generators and you had to make every single sound. Most of the synthesizers that people that are listening have touched, you can hit the saxophone button and then it sounds like a saxophone. Well, they've done that for you.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Exactly. So essentially, when you're listening to electronic music, one of the reason people get into it, any electronic music, is because you can hear timbres and things that you wouldn't hear in a physical instrument, in a real instrument. And it's also about the creativity of the patch.
I'm glad you said real.
Right. Well, you know, so basically a patch is just like the sound of that you've come up with your synthesizer. And, you know, it's infinitely complex, you know, and there's a whole bunch of different types of synthesis. But yeah, eventually you get to stuff where you actually have a, you know, like recognizable instruments played by a synthesizer. Right. Still a synthesizer, sounds like a harp. So there's a fun in sort of what sounds do people come up with and how creative can they be.
Yeah, I remember in high school, I'm just looking up, a friend of mine was a musician. I was just looking him up. I think he's actually done some stuff in music. But he had one of these synthesizers. This is like in 1984 maybe. And he could put a floppy disk in the synthesizer and he could make different sounds. And that was very cool. Like, he had one that was a cough. So you could go up and down the scale and play music with coughs and with dog barks and everything. And he was a fantastic saxophone player. His name was Bill Graber. His brother was in my class. He's a band director in Texas somewhere. So they're a musical family. But he's a good saxophone player. But then he would sit and just make up stuff with the sequencer and the synthesizer. And I never really got into it, but I was intrigued by it. And I mean, just, you can do whatever you want. If you're a musician, you can do whatever you want. And I have to say that again to understand how, for a musician, that for a composer, that's a big deal. So if I write a bit of music, like, I don't know, a little brass quartet or something, there's a limit to what I can do depending on the instruments that I have. And for me personally, I think it's fun to work in that. Mostly I did choir arranging for the last 20 years. But I can't do that note. I can't get that sound. I have a limited palette. You give me synthesis, I can do whatever I want in the world. I can make any sound. I can just go out with my recorder and like grab a dog, like a cat meow, and I can take it home and now it's part of my song. It's really very cool.
And
did you listen to Art of Noise in the 80s, Karl?
Yeah. A little bit. Yeah,
those guys did the hell out of that.
Yeah. And I think the key thing here is like, so what makes good electronic music good versus simply novel? Because certainly a lot of early electronic music got by on the fact that we hadn't heard this before. What the heck is that? But it didn't necessarily have a lot of redeeming qualities in its own sake beyond novelty. I think to make good electronic music, you have to curate it in a way that has a specific aesthetic, right? And if you listen to this album, you're not getting just like hundreds and hundreds of different tones. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they're not going wild with like, you know, it's very selected. It's very carefully crafted sounds. You know, when you listen to World in My Eyes, that the snare drum in there, it's not just any old drum. It's like a puh. Talk about the guy doing the cough. It almost sounds like someone saying "puh," right? like, why that? It's just, it all is very carefully selected to produce an effect.
Let's listen to that. World in my eyes. Where is it? Where is it? Where is it? Let's see if I can just listen to that. Strange.
That's not what a snare drum sounds like, right? It's a very, you know, it's very, very particular thing. So that part of what a good synthesis does, I think, and Alan Wilder, I believe, is the guy who's responsible for a lot of the programming on this album, is just coming up with interesting, cool sounds. I think Policy of Truth has a really cool and very bold move in the middle of the song. He comes up with like a saxophone sort of patch. And that's definitely one of those things where it's like, that could have gone real bad. And I can see Scott in his head. He's like, yeah, it did go real bad.
Well, let's see if we can hear it. It's so dated to
but
me.
But I think it was like... All right, so go for it.
Which is the best song on the album?
Yeah, I think so. Perfectly timed slide guitar. You had something to hide. Should have hidden it, shouldn't you? Now you're not satisfied with what you've been put through. It's just So I'm just going to talk to Karl for the rest of this episode.
It's fine. The kazoo phone or whatever it was they invented there. It's fine.
I just think that's so cool. I mean, it's like you could fall flat on your face putting that in this album, and I think they pull it off. I think it works.
It works.
I don't think there's a single... that's the thing about this album. I don't think there's a single instance where they drop the ball. Like, they start off in a certain groove, and they pull you into a world, and they never break the wall, the fourth wall.
I agree with that.
Like, you're always
in their world. Consistent.
And that's amazing.
It's entirely consistent, the whole thing. It holds that aesthetic. It creates that aesthetic and holds the thing for 1 hour and 12 minutes on this remastered album, for sure.
Yeah.
Now, the downside...
Go ahead.
But the downside is there's some saxophone player that didn't get that gig.
Yeah, and an electric guitar player. Listen in your right ear.
But would it have worked...
There it is. In my ear, that's like a faint electric guitar. How does this how does this stuff work? Like, you get a wooden tube and you get a double reed made out of some bamboo stuff, and some cute chick puts it in her mouth, and then you get a bassoon sound, and it's resonant and it's pleasing. You know, I didn't notice I didn't pick oboe because it's not pleasing, but it's pleasing and we like that, right? And then some guy in Italy takes some pine and some metal, some wood, and he shapes it, and then you bow it, and it's a violin, and it's a Stradivarius, and it's pleasing, and it has so those things, these things, these wind instruments, these string instruments, your timpani, you stretch this hide, you hit it, it rings, it's pleasing. They're creating these waveforms.
Yeah.
And then your head has a waveform detector in it, drum. And then it sends something in your brain, and then some part of you recognizes that, and you say, this is fair. Like I'm reading Hippias right now, Plato. This is fine and fair. Why are those waveforms fine and fair to us, as opposed to like, oh, well, this is the purest waveform? Like we could potentially, I can imagine a world where our aesthetics said, a completely clean slave oscillating at 440 cycles a second is exactly the proper tone to create heroic musics with, and this is what it is. It's so like
well, you're not ever going to get that sine wave in nature,
right?
That had to be discovered once we invented music synthesis. You know, you're not going to, you pluck a string on a guitar, it's already got all kinds of harmonics just from the act of plucking.
Well, you're probably not going to find pure fructose in nature either, but it hacks the human being and makes us great big and fat and diabetic. Like we, you know, you can't find alcohol in nature, you know. Well, I can, but you get my point. Like the sine wave exists in part in nature, not a pure one. It's always, you know, couched in this sawtooth form or whatever. But yeah. In many cases, technology being able to refine things lets us hack the human being a bit, you know, like in my example, or THC or nicotine or caffeine or all kinds of pleasing things, but not this. I don't know why they're pleasing. Is it because of nature? And if it is because they mimic nature, then shouldn't we beat all the synthesizers with a hammer and go ahead and do nature? Like, I don't know.
Well, probably we should throw out all recorded music and all digital communication and tools
and all
that.
Your terms are pleasing to me.
Yes.
Like, I mean, that's probably what we should do, but we wouldn't really have much of a show if that was the case.
Well, the waveform synthesis that Stradivarius did, whatever his name was, how many hundreds of years did that take?
All of them.
It took a long time to come up with the modern violin, which has pretty much stayed the same since it achieved final form.
Yeah.
But it took a while. Electronic music gives you the opportunity to do that in an afternoon. Will you find anything better than a violin? I don't know, probably not, but you can find different things.
Yeah, I do think that, so we've had electronic instruments, we've had synthesizers for about 60 years, give or take, you know, since the, early 70s. I'm sure I don't know when the first Moog synthesizer came out, but sometime around then, maybe the late 60s. I'm not too up on my history there. So it hasn't had as much time to be refined as the Stradivarius violin.
Yeah,
did.
Well, there's a performance difference too that you know, the violin, you're playing it with your hands. Trumpet, you're playing it with your breath. That's partly why this music, this particular album, is so limited in scope, and they chose to do it. But you wonder, I was listening to the tambourine in Policy of Truth and singing, is that a human? Are there any humans actually making this music except as the programmers? So there's something personal to maybe you can program it now. I've got some tracks from my little Reaper setup that sound almost like humans doing it. But I guess they'll hack that eventually too. But it's nice to feel like there's a human on the end and that you can feel the breathing, and it's almost like singing. I would say music in the end is all some kind of version of singing. And I suppose that's a downfall of electronic music is you get further and further away from it, and it's just a robot, and it doesn't feel like there's a human at all. They'll figure that out next year, probably.
Well, the time deep is coming. Music. Well, I say the time is coming. It's already come where we have deep fakes for music. This was a couple years ago now. Sony signed an algorithm to a record deal. And yeah, it was like a couple of, I don't know, probably Swedish guys. I don't remember. But it's a couple guys write this AI, essentially, that can write, it writes like ambient, you know, yoga music, essentially.
Yoga music.
And it's released a few albums already. And since then, Warner Brothers have signed.
What are its pronouns?
I don't even remember what it's called. You can go look it up, though. There's a number of them out now. It's not the only one, but that was notable because they got signed to a record deal and have put out commercial albums for a major label. But now we're looking at AIs that can almost dead on replicate Elvis singing. So the time is coming in the not too distant future where, you know, you can write a rockabilly song and have Elvis sing it.
Well, the algorithm can write the rockabilly song.
Well, yeah.
And then make Elvis sing it.
Right. And you know,
I want to do this album with Sinatra doing it.
Yeah, there'll be Sinatra too.
I want to have Sinatra sing Violator.
AI, this is a big problem, this thing that you're talking about. AI is impossible. Complex algorithm isn't. The AI will never be able to create. It will only be able to iterate. Right, you could make it. You could say, "I want a rockabilly album with Sinatra," and then you have this iterated thing, right? But the AI can never create a compelling new genre.
Sure. Yeah.
Now,
I agree with that.
Now, if you said rockabilly Sinatra is a new genre, well, you're just moving the goalposts on me. But if you expect to see a new kind of music or a new anything come from an AI, they cannot do it. AIs cannot do it. And but they can algorithm you to death. They can iterate you to pieces and ruin your life and will. But
yeah, sure. It can only draw on the body of recorded music that Sinatra has made and left us with. But they're never going to make a creative choice that Sinatra might have made. That we didn't get because he didn't record that song.
Or it can't even make its own creative choice.
Yeah.
Well, let's say it did. What if it? Okay, let's say the AI, which isn't really intelligence, but that's what people call it, comes up with Beethoven's 10th Symphony, and you know, from sketches or something, and finishes it. I think there was, and so now you have a computer composed according to an algorithm. 10th Symphony. You know, for me, this is like when Deep Thought or whatever it was finally beat Kasparov in chess. So now chess is over for humans. Humans are no longer the best at chess. I think we're still the best at Mahjong.
Go.
But it's getting close. So you have to sit and think, well, does that ruin chess? Now that the computers can play better than any human ever. Kasparov was the best player there's ever been, probably. If Bobby Fischer had not gone a little off the rails, maybe he would have been, but a little off the rails. If you're a chess fan, you know, I'm joking right there. Or you say, you know what? The game is good, and it's a game that humans play. And then you choose to do it as a human activity. So I actually did end up liking this album. And I think there's a whole bunch of fascinating stuff on electronic music, but when it gets to being composed, I think I have a dream that the new revolution is going to be kids saying, guess what? I got me a guitar. Why don't you come sit on my porch with me? You bring your harmonica. Or maybe you just sing, and then let's just do the music that we feel in that moment, you know, rather than having it end up be prepackaged and given to us according to, you know, whatever Facetagram thinks our wants and needs are.
Sure. Sure.
I think that'd be a cool revolution. I don't know. That's a dream. Maybe Eefing will come back. Did you notice there was Eefing on this album?
I did not.
Personal Jesus, I think.
Which track was that?
Yeah, I think it's in Personal Jesus.
Yeah.
This was another of the big radio hits from this album. Reach out, touch faith.
Kind of really liked Personal Jesus. I think this love song that's put in terms of religion, if it's really a love song, I mean, it's just weird. The refrain it's reach out and touch faith. So it's faith transformed into the physical.
I said, unless it was a girl named Faith. I'm married to Charity, whatever.
Gosh. Faith, hope, and charity. I note the singer is a convert to the Greek Orthodox Church. I thought that was an interesting little tidbit, you know? So this imagery, the whole album is like, if you read it in a certain way, the whole album is somebody who wants to have faith but can't have it. But is hoping. It's like in that waiting for the night to fall, there's a little spark of hope. Yeah. Maybe there's some hope somewhere.
Yeah, that's why this is a thing of Generation X. Like they want something higher and better, but just can't see it. They can see it by its absence. If you have an inkling of something good because of the space it leaves when it's not there, then your music and your art would almost necessarily have to be dark, because you only see the good through its absence. You don't see it through its positive influence. And I'm not saying there was nothing good in these people's lives, but I mean, I think that's what, you know, you said in the heavy metal episode that we did that it's concerned with the problems of the soul and higher things. And I think that's true. And I actually think that this is about problems of the soul too, but they haven't quite put their fix like some of the metal guys have. I saw those kids flounder, man.
Yeah. I mean, look at this. Yeah, I mean, look at this, the lyric, lift up the receiver, I'll make you a believer, take second best, put me to the test. So you can't have Jesus, but you can have me.
Yeah, I, this song, I think a lot of people could probably relate to, in that, like, there's probably someone in your life at some point that you have put your faith in, that's a, like, you've misplaced your faith in a person rather than a God. That's what this song reads to me as. It's like sometimes it can be a girl, it could be a boy, your own personal Jesus, someone who becomes like your personal savior, the person who's going to, you know, take away all of your pain, wash away your sins. And he's like, yeah, I'll pick up the receiver, I'll make you a believer. Just talk, you know, I think everyone has probably had that experience as a young person at some point or another, until you realize, like, yeah, all humans are,
oh dude,
we're all broken in our own ways. But, you know, we've all experienced having a personal Jesus that wasn't, it was a false idol.
Yeah, I don't know. I like personal Jesus. It's catchy. It's either cynical or hopeful. I think it's probably both. I mean, just knowing that that's what they want, even though they don't think they can get it, I think is, I think that's at least the direction. I like the lyric writing on this album. There's some, like in Halo, you wear guilt like shackles on your feet, like a halo in reverse.
That's pretty good.
I think that's pretty clever.
There's some, like, you know, these guys are like, there's some cheekiness, I think, which is just some good old British cheek. I think the album title Violator is kind of funny. It's intentionally being edgy and extreme. I don't think the album really, to me, it's not like, this is not a brutal death metal album.
Yeah, is it?
It's not exploring extremes. Maybe extremes of, like, you know, emotion at times.
It's like a Kiss album title. Violator.
Violator.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Right.
Gene Simmons on their 30th outing. Violator.
Does anybody pick these for, like, first dances at weddings?
Oh, my God.
For our first dance, we'll be doing Depeche Mode, World in My Eyes.
I still can't believe that you don't think this sounds dated. I don't know what to do about that.
Yeah, I think the production holds up.
I think so. A lot of 80s music to me sounds like Commodore 64 music. Mm-hmm. Real bright and I mentioned Human League. Can you pull up, you know, that one song that they had?
That one song. How dare you?
You were working as a waitress in a cocktail bar.
Oh, the hook girl on that is so great. Don't you want me?
Oh, don't you want me? Yeah.
But if you listen to, in the headphones, listen to the sound. It's like, these are like vacuum tube computers doing these sounds.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is like third level in Mario music.
It is.
This is my jam.
So this is electronica. There's probably not a real instrument in the room. Yeah.
Synth-pop.
But the
yeah.
But, I'd call this synth-pop.
So the texture of this track is thinner to my ears than the Depeche Mode stuff is. There's a whole lot more going on in Violator than there is on this track.
Yeah, and so, like, listen to the reverbs in Violator. You know, like, like, we talked about, like, how controlled and constrained that the aesthetic is. Part of it is like controlling space. Like there's nothing misplaced. Like every, you know, little drum hits will bounce from right to left. In Policy of Truth, we heard it like as the chorus comes in, there's like sometimes the drums get a little extra hit of reverb that spills out, but usually it's very controlled. It's like a gated reverb. The drum hits and opens up and then it closes down real fast.
Deciding in your youth on the policy of truth.
The part of this is like how you use this technology, right? You mentioned earlier that, you know, when you get a synthesizer, you go to the store, the music store, and you sit down in front of a synthesizer. There's a lot of other noise going on. You're not familiar with the equipment. Some of these synthesizers can be very, very deep in their architecture. So what are you going to do? Like you're going to sit down and you're going to pull up a preset and just start plinking around on it. Well, the manufacturers know that. So they design their presets primarily to catch your ear, and they have to sound current for whatever the current trend is. So if it's 1984 and you go to the music store just to pick out a synthesizer, you better hear some Human League type sounds in there. But you take that same synth in, you know, 98, and you're like, you start plinking that out and you're like, this is terrible. Like some Human League BS. I don't dislike the Human League, but you get my point, right? So part of the art in electronic music is taking the sounds that the synth gives you, seeing where you can push it. And like, I haven't found very many synths where you're going to like just pull it up. You'd be like, oh, yep, there's Violator right there. It's all in here.
Yeah.
I had a synthesizer that had a preset called Funky Town.
Right.
And it was the same as the song.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was thinking of an image. So if you watch computer animated stuff. So now we can do computer animation, but it doesn't mean it's good. So you could take the animation, say, of Shrek, which I think is awful. Just garbage. And then you could look at, say, Pixar's Brave. Mm-hmm. Where they've got this redheaded girl and every single strand of her hair is animated. You know, that's the difference between, and I like that Human League song, but that's the difference between Human League and, say, this Violator album. There's a lot more care taken into making the sonic structure of it, even though they're using similar tools.
Or any kind of Miyazaki movie.
Blows
Disney out of the water.
Yes.
Yeah.
In a cocktail bar, that much is true. But even then, I knew I'd find a much better place, either with or without you. The 5 years we've had have been such good times.
It was a pretty interesting time, and
I
think
that catch in her voice right there.
This, by 91 or 92, it was probably over. When a raft of new technologies let a whole bunch of new music appear, whether that was the Sugar Hill Gang and sampling and DJing that led to hip hop, or the 808 and leads to Run DMC and the Beastie Boys, or this, where you get the Human League and you get all of that British pop, and then this sort of Duran Duran goth pop. I think that there has been recently a kind of a raft of artists, quote unquote, that have come out of like Pro Tools, CADs, what is it? Audio desktop, whatever. Pro Tools is one of them. We use Reaper.
DAW.
Yeah. Digital audio workstations. We keep talking about Billie Eilish. She is because of that. You know, her brother can sit down and take control of every single detail of the recording sitting at an Apple computer and then create this thing. Mm-hmm. you know, there was a time when Leo Fender came up with some cheap guitars that worked real well, and you could have, you know, again, Buddy Holly Ricketts, or you could have the Beatles. You could have three or four guys do something interesting. And we are due for a new music, guys. We are long overdue. You know, we had rock and roll show up in the 50s. We had hip hop show up in, I don't know, 77 or whenever that was. I don't think that this electronica is actually new. I think it's an iteration. It's a kind of pop and dance music that has, you know, it's different instrumentation. As a genre, I don't think it's completely new. But we are so long overdue. Like, hip hop is coming up on 50 years old.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're overdue. I'm tired. I'm weary, huh?
Something slouching towards Bethlehem.
Well, I was about to bring up, like, I like to get on the Gear Page, which is a forum, and laugh at the boomers who are like,
who are guitars. Just,
like, oh, okay. Every week without fail, there's a big thread on Van Halen. And look, I love Van Halen, but good God, like, they do not have a huge body of work that's worth that's worth decades and decades of discussion. Like, as a band, they were great for a short period of time. They just, you know, there's not a lot of meat on the bone. And then now we have, like, what, Greta Van Fleet that's come out. That's, like, the biggest thing that people are all
about nowadays.
It's bad. It's bad. Oh, God.
It's like a Zeppelin imitator.
Yeah, Greta Van Zeppelin.
Greta Van Fleet, Highway Tune. 118 million downloads on Spotify. They're a verified artist.
It's a cover band.
Yeah. All right, whatever. If this was 1967, yeah. I'd have thought that was cool. Because it would have been new.
Yeah, right. Right. That's.
I don't know if we're going to have any music just because of the diversity of sources, unless Spotify pushes one. You know,
so what you're saying is if a new music appeared, we would may never become aware of it because the algorithm wouldn't put it in front of us.
Yes, that's kind of what I'm saying. I'm saying, you had sort of unified radio play. Mm-hmm. And so Buddy Holly comes along, and then a bunch of people are listening to Buddy Holly and then are all influenced by him. And then, you know, grunge comes along and a bunch of people are influenced by it. Unless they push something on us, I don't know that we would have one music come in. You know, there'd be some people over there that do it and some people over there that do it. But as far as having this movement that takes over the music world, I think that would be imposed these days.
Yeah, I don't.
Maybe it always was.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it always was. But then there was, like, that's why Nirvana was a big deal and Pearl Jam were a big deal, because they weren't, like, at the time when they broke, they weren't the band that was being groomed to be the next big thing. They kind of picked up some steam, and then the record labels were like, what the, like, I don't know what's going on here, but that's selling, so let's just put the hammer down. And then 5 years later, you get, like, Bush and garbage like that, right?
Bush.
But yeah, so there have been moments where sort of localized scenes pop up and sort of take over that were as genuine as you're going to get. Now, arguably, the guys who really created grunge, aside from maybe Soundgarden, didn't get the break. It was the Pearl Jam and Nirvana's that got the break, and they were actually the second go-around. You know, nobody talks about the U-Men.
Screaming Trees.
Or whatever, but yeah, I think you're right. I think that you have to have, like, a local scene to build any steam around, like, a new sound, unless it's being pushed from the top down. And who, like, where's the local scene? There's not one. I've lived in a bunch of big cities and no local scenes. it's bad because there's nowhere to play. That's a big issue. In a lot of cities, there's nowhere to play anymore. You know, bars don't want bands. They're loud. They suck.
But
often.
We'll have to make one, Trent.
They drive people away.
You come up to my shed and bring your stuff.
Yep. Got 10 acres to make noise on. Yeah, so I think you have to have people getting together in order for that to happen again. Like, we have to bring scenes back.
There's going to be a scene.
Yeah, I mean, that's... who knows where music's going to go? I have my hopes. I hope it gets smaller. I hope it goes down to the human level where I would like... I'm always telling the OGB members who ask about music, I say, do you play anything? Well, no. Well, get an instrument, play it. You know, more musicians makes better music. More musicians in your culture will make better music from your culture, even if you're not the one making it, but you're the one consuming it. And if you play a little bit, you're going to know a bit better that this is crap or this isn't. You'll expect more of the people that you go see.
Excellent. Yeah, I mean, if you pick up a synthesizer and you ever start messing around with one, you'll realize pretty quick that you can't come up with Violator. Good luck. I wish you the best of luck, but it's, you know, you get into it, and you're like, there's a lot more going on under the hood.
Thousands of hours of work to get those sound profiles.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, there's a little bit of this kind of a movement. Well, I mean, there are still people that use synths, and you can use those with your digital, you're a DAW. You can do that there. You don't even have to have a keyboard looking thing anymore. But you know, I've read about Taylor Swift. She'll go in the studio and just like beat on a cardboard box with a broom. They'll record that, sample it, play the sample backwards, and then that's one of the drum kit sounds. So because we have this all of this digital audio editing capability, you can use physical objects to create sounds and then sample those and then use them in new, and you can create instruments where there was none. So it's kind of a hybrid of synthetic and real. Yeah. So I was listening to, I don't know what all the Taylor Swift songs are, but she came on the radio the other day and I listened to it. And I was like, man, it sounds wonderful. Like just the instruments, the sound profile and kit, which probably wasn't actually a drum kit. It sounded perfect. Stupid song, but it sounded perfect.
Right. Yeah, the production's astonishingly good.
Yeah.
Sure.
She's an evil genius.
Yeah. An evil genius? She had a chance to not be.
Well, I think Max Martin is the evil genius.
Uh-oh.
Yeah, he's the real evil genius.
When are we doing a Taylor Swift episode?
Hey, your turn's next.
I think we should do a Max Martin episode. Yeah.
My turn's next. Well... Okay, so first of all, I probably will listen to this album again.
I will.
It took me a while to get to that stage. It's not in my lane, but it didn't suck. So thanks, Trent.
I'll take it.
You know, I really do think we need to do Dark Side of the Moon at some point. I think it's kind of similar to this in its soundscape, so it might be too much to do in 2 weeks.
You're in charge. You're driving, boss.
Well, let's do Dark Side of the Moon then.
All right.
Yeah.
And I hope that Trent will help me on some of the cool production stuff that they did, because that was an Alan Parsons project, as it were.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's a joke, boomers. They'll get it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's do that one. That, because that album was in fact on the charts for 20 years.
I think it might be the best selling album of all time. This is all off the top of the head, but I think it's like 100 million.
Yeah, it's my daughter Grace's favorite album. She loves it. And she coincidentally, she liked the Depeche Mode when I played it. Mm. So well, I don't think I'm alone in sensing there's similarities in the two.
Your daughter has good taste.
Trent, who was the mind behind Taylor Swift that you mentioned there? I didn't know this name.
Oh, yeah. So Max Martin produced, he didn't produce every one of her albums, but he produced 1989 or 80?
Yeah.
It's the album that had the year on it, had Blank Space and Shake It Off, probably her biggest hits. So that was Max Martin. And so if you didn't know, Max Martin, Shellback, and Dr. Luke are three guys. This is all their sort of stage names, if you will. These are three guys who are behind, 70% of all of the top 40 pop in the last 20 years. Max Martin worked with Britney Spears early on in the 90s. And, I mean, this guy has, I mean, he is maybe the most commercially successful songwriter of all time. But what's interesting and different from like early pop music is that these guys pretty much sit down and create the whole aesthetic, the whole, you know, everything. But yeah, those guys are the evil geniuses behind pop music.
I'm interested in doing some shows about dudes like that. Mark Ronson. That would be a good one. Butch Vig. I'm interested in some of those evil geniuses.
God, Butch Vig's. Yeah.
Butch Vig. Do you know Butch Vig, Karl?
Mm-mm.
He's the drummer for Garbage, but he produced Nevermind for Nirvana and tons of stuff. Like, he's got his fingers
Siamese
all
Dream
over.
For the Pumpkins.
Smashing Pumpkins, Green Day, Foo Fighters, more.
Yeah.
Yeah. And awesome.
Yeah, the magic touch.
Yeah. So I think that there's some of those guys behind the scenes. Our friend, the Matt Reynolds, texted me, and he loved the Outlaw Country show, and he's like, you've got to do one on Sun Records. And I was like,
yeah, that'd be fun.
That could be a good one. That could be a good
Absolutely.
One.
Absolutely. Yeah. Who is the guy behind Sun? Sam Phillips?
Yeah, Mr. Phillips.
Is that Sun? Yep. There's another evil genius. Yep. Barry Gordy, Motown. Yeah, there's a lot of these guys behind the
Phil
scenes
Spector.
That are, yeah.
Spector. Spector. All right, Dark Side of the Moon next time.
Yep.
And then, Karl, your homework is to listen to Pretty Hate Machine, Nine Inch Nails.
Okay.
Riley was really
How many
upset.
Listens will I have to give it?
One. How many do you think you'll have to give it?
Well, it took me about 11 for Depeche Mode, so that's...
Trent, how many Pretty Hate Machine listens will he take to get to the center of that Tootsie Pop? One?
Three.
Okay, yeah. We'll see. It's either one to three. I'll let you know.
I was saying before the show that in radio, it used to be an old saw that it takes 11. If you're going to break a song, if somebody's going to decide that they like a new song, it takes 11 exposures. They need to hear it 11 times before they decide if they love it or not. Now, sometimes it happens earlier than that, but that was the old thing. It's like if you're gonna test a new song in a new market, you got to play it at least 11 times before you know if it's going to hit or not.
A friend of mine handed me, it was actually a CD of Pretty Hate Machine, and it didn't take me 48 seconds. I was like, oh my God, what is this? Yeah, that was entirely new to me. Yeah, so a Pretty Hate Machine show and maybe a Skrillex show.
Oh gosh. See, that's my nostalgia. I saw Skrillex in college.
Oh, yeah?
After he broke. I saw Deadmau5, same venue. I saw Deadmau5 first. Great show. It was like a 3-hour show. It was crazy. He just DJ'd for the last hour and it was nuts. But it's like dance music fans, like people who are into electronic dance music. And then Skrillex happened like 8 months later. And I remember introducing him to all my friends, the Scary Sprites EP. And it was like, it was just crazy at that show. It was a terrible show. Like Skrillex was awful as a DJ.
Sure.
But people were just going absolutely nuts. Lots of MDMA.
Yes. Yeah, I was talking to my sister the other day. She was talking about going to a show like that. And of course, when Skrillex hit, we were already in our 30s or late 30s or something, you know. And she said, I went to the show, and all these girls were like, you're so pretty, and your hair is so soft. And she's like, I thought I was just wonderful. And then her friend is like, hey, they're all rolling real hard. And she's like, aw.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I thought I was cute.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's disgusting. Well, there's the Music and Ideas podcast. Thank you for sending me back to that time and place, Trent Jones. You transported me back to that purple room. And
yeah. So you're just sitting on your tractor, like plowing green fields, and then you get to go back to that black and purple room.
Yeah, I got stories to tell about that when we can't, when we're not recording. Go to onlinegreatbooks.com/podcast and sign up for our waiting list there and our mailing list. Maybe go buy something and pass this show around if there's one of these that you like that was about something you hate or something you love. Send it to somebody else. You know, share the show, because the algorithm doesn't share the show, because we often partake in fair use of copyrighted materials. And the algorithms have no regard for fair use, so they just don't send us around. So do that for us. That's a big help to us, and that's the only way this show is going to grow. It's the only way. iTunes, Google Play, the Spotify's, none of those are going to promote this show because of the format.
You have to fight the power.
Yes. All right, thank you guys so much for listening, and we will talk to you in 2 weeks.